All right, amazingly, that was actually a full 2 minutes. So let's go. Here we go. We are going to do the evolution of class patterns that you guys have been cracking on for so long with the help of our TAs. Hopefully, two things are true. First, you have worked so hard to make progress in the repo, difficult though it may have been, that you will have a lot of perspective on the solutions I'm about to provide. If you did not work in the repo sufficiently to understand this material very personally, it'll make sense logically, but maybe you won't have made all the errors that I'm about to describe. If you haven't done the repo to that degree, it's okay. You should totally ask questions. Your questions and curiosity are valid. But I'd like you to apply your experiences, if you have them, to this conversation. And try to like relate what I'm doing to what you tried to do, what problems I see there as being needed to solve in my code that inspire my edits, and how they map to the concerns you had. Maybe compare and contrast them out loud. Raise your hand and let me know what you were thinking about when you started to approach the prompt, and how it differs from the way I'm characterizing it. That's the first thing. The second thing is that I want you guys to understand the changes that I'm making and what motivates each change so well that after this talk, you will be able to go trivially solve these problems. They should make perfect sense. Each of the edits I make should make perfect sense as to why, what motivates the change I'm making, and how I'm exactly achieving the improvement to my code that I'm striving for. So, just to put a very fine point up, if at any point in this lecture, this is the most important one for us to agree to this on, if at any point I say something that you are not very confident you could apply, you are doing yourself and the room a grave disservice. We need your feedback as to what you found difficult and what you still find difficult, such that you would be able or not be able to solve the problem in the prompt. One last note, since we are starting in on our last lecture, and I've had a fantastic time talking to you guys. I'm Marcus Phillips, I'm from Hack Reactor. Every 7 weeks, a new group of people shows up. We teach that group of people for 13 weeks, and we bring them from very beginning developer or very experienced developer to a much more honed and capable and accomplished developer. That's our whole bag, so I teach these lectures a lot, and my personal interest is in figuring out where people's brains typically diverge from the way things really are, and trying to get good at noticing those divergences so that I can correct them and improve the slides to reflect what I've learned about how you learn. If you're interested in this kind of learning, by all means, talk to someone on the team, talk to my brother Tony, one of the co-founders, talk to me, or pick up one of these postcards that's laying around. You can find more information about our class in San Francisco. Also, if you've enjoyed this talk, I would encourage you to give some feedback, or if you didn't enjoy it for some reason, that's totally fine. I call on you. I expect I will piss somebody off. I always do. There's always one. There's always one who's very upset about that. But it's this guy. He's like, that's me. Nonetheless, we really appreciate feedback. It's a central aspect of how we do our work. Positive, negative feedback, we are thrilled to get an opportunity to hear what worked for you and what didn't work for you and how we can make it better. If you have suggestions for my slideshows and how they can be modified a little bit because you figured something out after we were talking or you and a TA were working on it, you're like, that's the thing I wanted to hear. I love knowing about that stuff, so please come find me after if you have any suggestions. And please do tell the conference organizers if you enjoyed this or not. So, let's talk about evolving a piece of code from one class pattern to another. Here we have manual creation of two objects, buggy and viper. This should look familiar. We just did something similar. Buggy and Viper get a speed assigned to them, they get a location, and they get a move method, and we suddenly realize a problem in our code. What is it? That's okay. But as a programmer, looking at this code, you might recoil and say, ew, what's going on with all that code duplication? Right? The two blocks look very similar. We're doing the same work here as we're doing down here. Yep, yep. Totally fair. So. Yeah. The only difference between these two big blocks of code is what? Where does it diverge? Where do the two blocks look different? That's one difference. They're being stored in different variables. The speed starts out at a different number. So we could fix this by having a
mix-in.
We could have a mix-in, or we could use a class. Perfect. Thank you. We would specify this class by defining a JavaScript blank.
Constructor.
Constructor, which is a function. We would build a constructor function or a maker function, and that function would just take the specific details about that new thing, the one aspect that's different about it, as an input. So let's write that function real quick. It's a function that takes in an argument, builds a result object and returns it, and in the middle it's going to do all that same work. Set whatever the input, that's the new speed, and then the location is always zero, and the move function looks the same as ever. Any questions or, you know, issues, curiosities about the code as we've evolved? We went from duplicated code to using a maker function. So, I would claim that the definition of a car factory in this world is one where we just need to know what the top speed is, or the current speed, and it builds us all of the details. We could imagine a different car factory that takes in more arguments and makes more interesting or more detailed cars, but I'm okay with the fact that speed is the only input to this maker function, personally. I'm thinking like concerns we have with the code as it's written, maybe performance concerns, something you would put in a code review. Yeah?
Well, we've written this as a function, right? I thought we were going to make a class on it.
The proposal was that this is just a function and we need a class. I don't know if you were here for the code sharing patterns talk, but I made the claim that any function that returns a similar object every time you call it counts as a class. And in fact, other languages, Java?
Yep, a little bit.
A little bit? What is your main language?
Oh, JavaScript.
JavaScript, okay. Other languages have complicated the notion of a class, including JavaScript. It's culpable to some degree for complicating the notion of a class to be something more than just a function that produces a fleet of similar objects. But in fact, any function that produces similar objects every time you call it is a class. At least it meets the bare minimum definition of a class. So, I don't like the fact, or one could take issue with the fact, that the move function here is going to be created every time we call car. How many move functions are there in total when we're done running this program? if the tan brown shirt and green mushroom one up here.
So you don't like the fact that the move function is
So I guess my question would be, if all of this code were to run, how many total functions would have been created by the interpreter that are currently taking up space in memory? How many different unique functions will be created by the end of running this code?
Six.
What led you to the number six? Where's initialize?
I don't know. I don't know the answer.
That's fair. That's fair. So when the code starts running, it starts here, and it says, "Hey, car is a function," and it skips all of these lines of code and comes down to here. So that's one so far, right? The interpreter just got past this first line of code, this function declaration, and then it hits this line of code and it calls the car function, right? So we've got one function in existence, and we are in the middle of calling the car function. It jumps up to here, and it starts chugging along, and it hits this line, and it builds a function to store on the move property, right? So now we're up to two. We get done, we return the result, it gets stored in buggy, and we go on to the next line, where we call car again. You see where I'm going with this? How many functions are we at so far? We're at two. How many do you think we're going to have in total by the time the whole program is done running? Three, exactly. We're going to run this car function again. When we hit this line, we build a third function, even though two of those functions are doing the same exact thing. One is for moving the buggy, and the other is for moving the Viper. They're taking up different spaces in memory. You could claim that this is memory inefficient. Perhaps you would prefer to have a single move function that all cars can share. That is the argument in favor of the functional shared pattern that we are going to move towards. So this is the step that you had better understand if you want to make progress in the assignment. Tell me if there's anything confusing about this plan, this transition. You take this function here, and you move it down out of this function here. You want it outside the function. I happen to be storing it as a property of some rando object, but that's not interesting. That's just where I'm putting it. I have var car methods, which is just a little bucket for me to store everything I want on cars. By moving the function out of here and then copying it onto the result every time, I whittle down the number of functions from 3 to 2. Can someone, thumbs on your confidence that you could tell me the story of two and exactly two functions coming into existence as this code runs? Easy. Hard. Somewhere in the middle. Could you, in the brown shirt, could you tell me the story of how this code results in exactly two functions existing in the whole program?
So like you were saying earlier, the first function is that car function.
Yeah.
Which is, as you're stepping through the code.
Yeah.
And doesn't do anything. But then when you get to the instantiation of...
Oh, hang on, you skipped some stuff.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, car methods is... being instantiated or declared there, and then you have this car methods. Is that a dot?
Yeah.
I can't see that.
Dot move.
Dot move. That is going to have another function.
So how many functions do we have total so far?
Two. Right.
Two functions.
And then when you later on, after your later comment, you're instantiating bugger and Viper. And to my way of thinking, they're just going to use the functions that you've instantiated earlier.
Well, let's dig into that. So you were correct that we first made this function, and then we jumped down here, we made that function, we got to here. And then we ran car. Where am I going next?
You're going back up.
Back up to here.
Yeah.
So now, talk me through running this function. Tell me if you see any any new functions being created inside of it.
No, I don't.
No. What about this line?
It's just a pointer, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah. We're copying a reference from this shared move function onto the result object. So this new line of code is more efficient, memory efficient, than the old line of code, because the old line of code had to build a brand new function every time we hit it. If we made 10,000 cars, there'd be 10,000 move functions, and that seems inefficient. The new code just makes 10,000 references to one function.
Is there a particular reason you're putting, you're creating a car methods object instead of just creating a car methods function to hold that?
Car methods function.
You're creating car methods as an object and giving the move attribute to the function of that function there.
Uh-huh.
What is the benefit of doing that as opposed to just saying car methods equals function and the function?
You're saying car methods equals and then this thing here?
Yeah.
So that would be more like var move equals this thing here, because car methods would be a misleading name for this function.
Right.
The proposal is, why did we make a car methods object and then put move into it instead of simply saying var move equals a function and then saying result.move equals move? We could do that. The reason I did this was to kind of provide a common bucket where I put all methods that have to do with cars. So if I had a reverse method, and I had a explode method, and I had a fly method, and that's all stuff cars can do, I wouldn't have 5 or 10 global variables to store each of those methods. I would have one global variable with this car methods object in it, and the car methods object would store everything related to cars. It's a minor improvement, it's not important. You're totally right, I could have just said var move equals. But this is more forward compatible. As we build more and more methods, they're all going to live under one namespace. Does that seem fair?
I like it.
Okay. Yeah.
Why not instead define your function with the name car, like function car c, and then add those methods of move or whatever else as part of the prototype?
I'm having a little trouble hearing some of the words you're saying.
Oh. Why not have like function car, and then set the prototype methods of that?
Well, we haven't explored the idea of the prototype methods. Okay. That's a feature that we have not revealed the existence of or the motivation behind, but we will get there for sure.
Okay, in this session.
In this session, we will explore all the different ways you can do it. But right now, we're taking baby steps along the evolution of JavaScript. We are actually following, approximately, the track that you, or another person, or Brendan Eich, would take as they invent the language. So at one point, Brendan Eich maybe had this version of the language. It supported this kind of class. And he was like, yeah, that's pretty cool. I like it. Oh, wait, it's really memory inefficient. I know. I will tell people to write classes like this. That way, they can all share the same function. It's a little complicated. It takes about an hour or 10 hours of lecturing for people to really come to understand. But that's okay. You know, seems like the memory improvements are worth it. We're eventually going to add more and more improvements. Any other questions about what we see so far? Here's a tough one. First of all, I would like to challenge you to ask a question that relates to This is an exercise. This is actually less about my lecture right now and more about your learning opportunities. As learners, as listeners, you will be constantly tempted to take a passive role in listening to the speaker. Some speakers actually enforce this. They're like, yeah, shut up, I'm talking. Right? I clearly am not that guy. But as listeners, you might be tempted to go, I'm hanging in there, I guess I'll look that up later, and like, no, I think I get that. And you won't necessarily be transforming your potential failure in the future into a question right now today. And so I would like to challenge you to measure how well you understand these concepts and how applicable you think they are yet, how well you think you could apply them. And if you see a gap, voice it right now. Find words for the gap between your sense of your ability to apply this information and like a usable level of understanding what I've said.
Yeah, I believe I totally understand what you just done here, and it makes total sense, and this is in hindsight, right, after you've explained it. I'm struggling with, will I be able to recognize this? Running through a code or writing code, will I be able to, will it jump out at me? Oh, I got it. You know, so I'm trying to figure out the pattern, or what is it that I need to look for in order to recognize that so it becomes readily, you know, visible.
Great question. So his question is, what is the salient stuff I can see on the screen right now that's going to cue to me what pattern I'm looking at? And I guess I need to know more about what you mean by that pattern. Like what are you asking to be able to identify?
Okay, so it seems like, you know, because we have, I guess, anonymous function. I guess it's not anonymous since you assign it to something, but yeah, I'm trying to recognize, okay, what do I need to look for further, you know, in the future when I'm writing code or when I'm reviewing other people's code that would make this readily apparent?
To make what readily apparent?
The fact that we're inefficiently using referencing functions.
Okay. So the question is, how can I tell when functions are taking up more memory than necessary? The answer to that question is, when you see a function definition inside another function definition, there will be as many of these as there are times you call this. So pretty much a function inside a function, you gotta ask yourself, how many times is the outer function running? Could I possibly use a shared function? You can use a shared function whenever you don't need access to closure scope variables. See how this function does not refer to result or any other local variables? That means I can move it out. It refers to this, but the keyword this is kind of special. This actually facilitates function sharing. So I can move it out. This is more efficient, debatably. It's functional instantiation, like this was, but it's functional instantiation with shared methods because they are not inside the maker function. Does that make sense? That's exactly the thing you should look for.
So var car is a constructor, right?
So the word constructor happens to have a specific meaning, and in JavaScript I'm not allowed to use the word constructor as pertinent as it seems. You're in spirit correct, but technically we use the word constructor to mean a little bit more specific thing than just a maker of instances. A maker of instances doesn't have a great name.
Okay, so it's a maker of instance, var car. So whenever you have a maker of instance, inside of it you want a function like we did, like result.loop. That means whenever we instantiate another car class, like car, var, let's say you have a var name, Honda equals car, and it goes 50, speed of 50. Every time you do that, you're going to have, every time you have a function in a maker class, maker statement, whatever, do you want to use a shared?
Yes, the answer to your question is
yes. That's kind of what it sounds like, what you're saying.
In effect, if you want to reuse functions in the interest of memory reuse and efficiency, then you don't want to see the word function inside any of your maker functions.
Okay.
You want to move those out if you possibly can, and just copy references onto the instance.
All right.
Great distillation of the idea there. Any other questions? Yes.
Sometimes it used to be JavaScript about things that are like available in JavaScript and things functions that you need to write or code because something seems to go do something dot delay or something like that. Whereas you've got like other things before the dot and I'm looking at this and looking at the function and the speed of the brackets and I'm confused about where
You're curious about the speed property of cars.
Yeah.
Is there a specific line where speed is at issue?
Well, I can say that,
speed has, there are two different uses of the word speed, the identifier speed in this code. One is a local variable to the car function provided as an input. That's the first of the two uses of the word speed. It's a variable that gets passed in here and given a name here. That's the first, I'm not done with there too, but I just want to make sure the first one makes sense. The word speed inside this function refers to whatever was passed in at invocation time. It's a local variable. Does the first case make sense? Okay, so it's very similar to basically any function from any language in that the parameter list lets you give names to what gets passed in, and later you're going to call the function passing in a specific value. So for example, if I was writing a sum function, var sum equals a function that takes a and b and returns a plus b, a and b are the names of local variables that were input into the function, and when I call sum of 3 and 4, a and b take on meaning temporarily, and that's a variable as well as a function input. Does that seem fair? I think that's cross-language. In this situation, speed is exactly one of those. But there's a second appearance of the word speed. We're using it coincidentally as the name of a property on the result object. When someone passes a speed in, we want to make that speed, we want to tack it on to the object. We could have called it velocity. I mean, that would be inaccurate sort of in terms of physics, but we could give it a different name here on this object. It doesn't have to have the same name as the identifier for the variable name, but we chose to call it speed in both cases. One's a variable and the other is a property name. Let me know if you want to dig into that anymore after. Yeah?
I sort of a high level question about this pattern. It seems to me like it's ambiguous if you're just looking at the car method, or if I'm an IDE and I want to help you practice the code. How do I know from within the definition of the move function that this has a location property, or this has a speed property, and that I can make use of that?
So unfortunately, and I hate telling people not to ask questions, but in this case there was a whole lecture on the keyword this, which I would recap for you if it weren't for the fact that I know a majority of the audience heard it, but you and I should talk afterwards, because it's a very interesting question how you can assess the fact that the keyword this will refer to what we want it to.
Well, you remember, I was there.
Oh, okay, sorry about that.
I said that, you know, this basically, wherever you call the function, you look before the dot, and that's the object that this will be.
Yes.
Right. I just mean, just within the context of defining the car method, it move. I would expect a move function to take a parameter that is explicitly in a car, so that you know that it can only be called on something that has.
Sure, but remember, the keyword this is a function input.
Yeah.
There's very little difference between the keyword this and an actual function input, other than how you determine what it gets bound to. At call time, you look a little bit different. You don't look between the call time parens. You look to the left of the dot, or you check for the keyword new, or you do some other things. At call time, you can determine what is being passed in for binding to the keyword this. So the intuition you have around treating this like a function input will actually work. I think you're concerned that it wouldn't work, but you can use those rules to treat it exactly like that.
In this case, though, this wouldn't work because you have.
I don't mean to cut you off. It's just he was about to say something. I want to make sure I finish chatting.
So just to draw that to a close, so if you were to rename the car's location
property, or the result, I guess. Results location property to position. What would be your indication that you need to go somewhere else into car methods and make sure that this dot location is connected to this?
Got it. So you're saying, how can a static analyzer that can read my code ensure that whatever this refers to has a dot location property? Seems as though currently the only way I can be confident in it is by reading the source code of my constructor, which I believe this function will be run in the context of its instances. So I think this function should run on things that look like this, but I can't be sure. You're actually totally right. JavaScript totally plays hell with static analyzers. It does not, it is not conducive to being statically analyzed. Because so much is determined at runtime. The keyword this has no strict meaning the way it does in Java. It's the keyword this, the binding is determined at runtime, and therefore, it's not possible for a static analyzer to make assurances about what the keyword this will refer to. Any more than a static analyzer can make assurances about what variables get passed in, unless you have like type specification, which we don't have in JavaScript. Great question. And sorry, I misunderstood your question at first as being something different than you were asking. Sorry, did you have another one?
No, was it the same? I wasn't sure if this is going to work, right? Because this would be the window object in this case. Because you haven't created a constructor with a new.
Ah, no, this actually will work.
Because car is just a variable.
The capital C car?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this would refer to the window object, would refer to window if you run it on the browser.
You're saying if I run buggy.move, I will be operating on window.location, which will navigate me to a new web page?
Inside of car methods.move, if you do console.log this, that this would be the window object, wouldn't it?
That is a very tempting suspicion. It just isn't true, and I can show you. But this is a very reasonable intuition. So the claim is, maybe when we console log car inside the move method, we should expect it to be...
Yeah, if you do console.log this.
This, we're going to see window whenever we call move.
Sure.
So buggy.move, we're going to see window pop up. In fact, we're going to see buggy pop up. Speed, location, move. And the reason has to do with the binding rules around the keyword this. When you want to find out what the keyword this refers to, as a quick recap, you take a look at the keyword this that you're curious about, you scan outward to the function that it's within. You then look for where that function is called. So scanning down, we see here's the calling context. Whenever there's a dot, you can look to the left of the dot, and that is the context that it will be called in. Whenever you see a method invocation style of a invocation of a function, the thing to the left of the dot will be the target context. But I totally see why that would seem to be the opposite, and unfortunately, the window binding is one of the most misleading aspects of the language. Okay, so we are tacking move onto result manually. But if we had 50 different methods of cars, all stored down here in car methods, I'd have to copy them over one at a time. Maybe I could do it all automatically with my handy extend function. This means basically that. The two mean almost exactly the same thing. Extend just says find all the properties of car methods and copy them onto this result object. There is only one property of car methods, but there could be many if I edited my code, and they would all get copied onto result. Basically, doing this over and over and over again, once per key. Does that make sense? Are there any questions about the transition from this manual assignment of a single property to the automatic assignment of every property? This is an unimportant transition. The important one is the next one. So I want to switch out of functional instantiation with shared methods. And I want to go to I want to go to prototypal instantiation. Prototypal is what Brendan Eich invented before Netscape asked him to change it to make it look more like Java. What you all use day to day, almost certainly, and certainly what you found documented on the internet, is called pseudo-classical. Douglas Crockford at least calls it pseudo-classical, and the name is kind of stuck for a lot of people. The original intention of the language was that it would be a prototypal language where class creation was done with manual wiring to prototype objects. So, if you were writing the language and you thought, you know, people are doing a lot of copying of properties, I thought it was great that I dragged this function out of here because I save a bunch of memory, but the copying time for classes that have a lot of methods, the copying time onto an instance is taking too long. Let's say I have a method like a DOM node that has gads and gads of methods and properties and all of this stuff I need to put on every instance. I'm copying lots of methods. Why don't I use a prototype system so that all of my instances delegate to one object? So in this world, I want it to be the case that Buggy and Viper are both objects that delegate somewhere rather than get properties copied onto them. That's the motivation of this next change. Thumbs on the confidence that you could repeat the motivation of moving towards this prototype system.
Could you repeat?
Yes, I will just repeat it. So the motivation goes, Buggy and Viper currently are getting methods copied onto them at creation time. Right after they're created and before they get returned, we copy all of these functions onto them. Yeah? Instead of this copying process here, I wish that instead Buggy and Viper were created such that they delegated to some object that had all of the relevant methods, like move. That way I wouldn't have to do a lengthy copying operation every time I construct an object. Instead, when I interact with Buggy and I say buggy.move, there is no buggy.move, but there is one on Buggy's prototype, and so it seems as though Buggy has a .move. That's the idea that Brendan Eich was following when he decided to make JavaScript a prototypal language. And so my question goes, what object would you want Buggy and Viper to delegate to?
Car.
This is what everyone guesses, and it's not true. You might think you want Buggy and Viper to delegate to the car function object itself. So that if you said buggy.move and there wasn't a move function on Buggy, or let's say you wanted buggy.radioOn, right? You might want it to be the case that buggy.radioOn is not found and it falls through to some other object, like car itself. That would mean we would have to start putting the move function onto the car object, and there would be like a gas pedal on the car factory itself. Capital C-A-R is a car factory. So to move, if the car factory itself had a move function, that would imply that the factory could drive away.
So you need a car object that's separate from the car factory.
Exactly. The conclusion that you would draw, and that Brendan Eich drew, was that there should be some object that represents the quintessential car. And all cars will delegate to this quintessential object. It'll be a car prototype. In this code here, what object is a good candidate for having Buggy and Viper delegate to them? Car methods, fantastic. That is rarely guessed, but you got it. If Buggy didn't have this extend operation happening, and instead just delegated to car methods, then it would work perfectly. Buggy.move doesn't exist, but it falls through, and car methods.move exists, right? So we want to set up a delegation relationship from every instance to this car methods object. That's a solution to a problem. Do you understand both the problem and the solution? Okay, follow-up question for you. Do you remember how you make prototype delegation relationships in JavaScript? Yes, it's object.create. You are on fire. At what point in an object's lifecycle are you allowed to use object.create? When the object is created. Yep. And only at the moment that the object gets created. You cannot change an object's prototype, so you have to bring it into this world having the prototype you want it to have. That means that one of these lines of code is exactly where we're going to set up the prototype delegation relationship. Can you guess where I'm going to have to set up a prototype delegation relationship from every car instance object to car methods?
Just use the car methods and just...
So remember, he just said that the only moment you're allowed to define the prototype delegation relationship is at the moment that an object is created, right? Okay. So we're trying to set up prototype delegation relationships from Buggy and Viper to car methods. Which begs the question, when were Buggy and Viper created? This is kind of where they're created, but let's go into detail about the moment the object comes into existence. When I run this function, I jump up here, when does the instance show up for the first time? This is me creating the buggy and me creating the Viper. This result object here, that's just the name that we're giving to the thing that will eventually become a buggy or become a Viper. Right?
Yeah.
So that is where I need to insert my prototype delegation logic. If I want the buggy and the Viper to delegate to car methods, which remember, I definitely do, then the moment I need to do that is right here. This is where those cars got created. Are we on board with my claim? Because we're going to show you the code for it, but I want to make sure you know what problem that code is going to solve. What do you think? Yeah? Sweet. So there it is. I took away the object literal, and I replaced it with object.create. Remember the crazy box? Whatever you pass in is the thing that will be delegated to. So, car methods, this is the input. And the output of this function will be a brand new object that delegates to car methods. Perfect, problem solved. The other thing I did is I took away this extend call because I don't need to extend it anymore. That's the copying operation I'm trying to get rid of. Are there any questions about this transition? I have just moved from functional instantiation with shared methods. In one tiny transition, this is your second leap in your assignment. And it's tiny. You just say, oh, well, instead of the result being a brand new object that I eventually augment with a bunch of stuff, I'll just make it an object that delegates to the ship to the centralized thing. I hope I didn't piss him off. He really wanted it to be true that he would this for it to win. I was trying to be polite. Does this transition make sense? And do you feel as though you could implement this transition for your own exercise? Yeah? If there's any confusion, it's probably shared by everybody. All right, let's keep going. We will be around for a while so you can keep hammering on this stuff. Okay, car methods is currently a global variable, yeah? global variables, people don't like them for some reason, they seem to be bad. Okay, let's get rid of the global variable. Instead of car methods being its own object that's just out there in space, let's make it an object that I keep as a property of car. This is just a different place to put it. Instead of in the global scope, I'm going to put it on the car object, the car function. Does this seem fair? Nothing interesting has happened. No new rules kick in. There aren't new relationships between buggy and this object. There aren't new relationships between this car function and this object, other than that you can find it as a property of that object. But that doesn't have anything to do with the scope or the keyword this, nothing. It's just I'm giving it a different name. Instead of calling it the global variable car methods, I'm calling it, you know, that function object dot methods. This is just house cleaning. It's a better place to put that object. How? Yes?
Does that mean that you can decode on something else and then be used by?
Does that mean you can do what?
So you can have other things other than methods on the car, right?
Car dot something else. No, so I think you are postulating the existence of some other like impact that this transition should have. But there is basically no interesting change that has occurred. This is just a naming change. I mean, I could have changed it from car methods with an S to car methods with a Z, right? And you would not feel as though that meant something weird was happening. We're just changing the variable name, right? Sorry, but before, do you mind if I walk through a couple of sort of like steps? If I change the variable name from having an S to having a Z, you would not be confused about that. That would not seem like anything interesting happened at all. What if, instead of calling it var car methods equals an object, I said, I'm going to put it on the math object. You know, math.random and math.pow and all that stuff. It's just an object where they store math functions. Do you know what I mean? Like if I call math.random, I get a random number. It's just where they store the random number generator. The random number generator is stored as a property of this object. But maybe that is intuitive or maybe not. Math is an object that has a bunch of properties on it, like math.py. So I could also have stored this, I could put just a function inside math.py. I could say math inside math. I could say math dot, you know, foo equals an object. And now I put my own thing on math. No big deal. It's just a place to store stuff. Does this step seem fair? Perfect. And I'm not expecting you to carry it forward to a conclusion just yet. I just want to make sure that we're agreed on some fundamentals. So putting var flu equals an object, it's just a variable name. Math.flu is another place that I could put a thing. It's just places to put things. So what I'm saying is, car methods was one place to put things. Car dot methods is just a different place, but no new behaviors are made possible by this.
Is the reason why you can do car dot methods before you create a new variable?
Yes, car is an object that already exists. It wasn't creating the variable that made it possible. It was making an object that I stored in that variable. So now when I talk about CAR, I'm talking about the function object specified from this F to this curly brace.
And would one of the benefits of changing it to that be that you just kind of just
one, so what are the benefits of it? Yeah, I guess you could say consistency. My favorite benefit is that there are fewer global variables. In this world, there were two of them. Car was a global variable, and car methods was a global variable. It seems as though there are two different objects kicking around relating to the idea of making cars. But this way, one of them is tucked tucked inside the other and keeps it kind of tidy, and there's only one global variable. It supports encapsulation. If I pass the car funk factory to another system, it's going to get the whole kit and caboodle all at once.
So even though car, like you said, is like a factory that creates cars, it also stores, and it wouldn't make sense for it to have a property like moving, it stores sort of like within it properties that are relevant to cars that are made in that factory. Does that make sense?
I did not quite track on that. It sounded like a good question, but I didn't sleep really.
I was just saying, so before, the reason we made car.methods, or I mean, the reason we made car methods as a separate thing was because we were saying, well, it doesn't make sense for a factory to move. So now we're just sort of tucking those properties of cars into the object of the car factory so that they're accessible, even though they're not necessarily characteristics of the factory.
Yes, yes, exactly. So I'll reiterate what you said in terms of Catherine's original question. Catherine, that was your name, yeah?
Kathleen, sorry.
Kathleen proposed that maybe we want to store move as a property of car. And this seems pretty similar to storing it as a property of car. It's storing it as a property of an object that is a property of car. So why did I say no to Kathleen earlier and then do this myself? Because I have namespaced all the methods to one object, so I'm not confusing the things that are true about the car factory with the things that are true about the quintessential car. I put them in different buckets. The things that are true about the car factory are like, how many cars has it produced up until now? Let's say I had a car factory and on the side I was keeping notches of how many cars it's made, right? I would have to store that at car.notches. But in Kathleen's proposal, all cars delegate to the car factory in order to get their move method. Car.move is there, so buggy.move delegating to car would work because the car factory itself has an engine, it can move. It has a gas pedal, it can move. But then buggy.notches would exist, which doesn't make any sense. We're mixing together the things that are true about car factories and the things that are true about the quintessential car that everything delegates to. My solution here does not mix those things together. My solution here puts the things that are true about quintessentially every car, it puts them all in methods. Okay, some people are disturbed by the fact that I put methods as a property on car. They're like, wait a minute, what do you mean? You guys probably remember from the other day that functions are just objects and they follow all the rules of objects and you can store properties on them. But just to really send the point home, I would contend that this code is unconfusing to you. Making a car object and then adding a property to it that stores another object, you're like, well, yeah, easy. And I'm saying this is very similar. It's almost completely the same. We are using a function as our container. There's a function object, but that's not particularly different. Okay, I'm about to make probably the largest conceptual leap of the lecture, and I want you guys to go with me for a second. Here's what we're gonna do to reinforce this and make sure you don't trip up on the way through it. Could you please open your computers and type into a console somewhere, var foo equals F-U-N-C-T-I-O-N, paren paren, curly brace, just make a brand new function and store it in the variable foo. Var foo equals, and then build a function. It doesn't have to have anything in the function body, just F-U-N-C-T-I-O-N, paren paren, curly brace, enter. So you've made a new function and you've stored it in the variable foo. Quick poll. What properties do you think that foo object, the function you just created, has? What do you think it has, Jacques?
What properties does it have?
Yeah, what properties does this foo object suddenly have, this function you just created?
Well,
No properties at all. Decent guess. Atlassian, do you know of any more properties that it would have?
I'm assuming it has something since you're going on, but I don't
know. No, yeah, we don't know. What if I were to tell you?
That type?
Object.
The string should be a function.
Two string. It has two string, yeah? Everything has two string. It gives you a string version of it. Okay, it has some methods on it, because all functions have some methods. What if I was to tell you that Brendan Eich was looking at some code, some class that he wrote, and he thought, you know, every time I write a class, I do this right here. I say constructor function dot methods equals an object. And I do that so that I can make the instances delegate there. And he was thinking about that, and he thought, maybe every function should just come for free with a dot methods property. Right? Every single function that you ever make. Because there's like a 2% chance you'll use that function as a class. That function may just be like the sum function that does some work for you. But there's like a 2% chance that that function is going to be a class. And so to simplify matters, every function in the whole language will automatically come with a dot methods property. What I'd like you to do is type into your console, but don't press enter. Do me a favor, don't press enter. Type in your console foo.methods and then don't press enter. Did you press enter? You pressed it.
Not yet.
Don't press enter.
I was doing
this. You do not call foo. You just say, nor do you call methods. You just say this exact line, F-O-O dot M-E-T-H-O-D-S, and don't press enter. So what I'm telling you is, when you do press enter, which won't be now, I will tell you, I promise. When you do press enter, it's going to show you that there's an object there stored at the key methods on this brand new function that you just created in front of your eyes. Why would that function be there in the blue shirt with the glasses? Why would there be a dot methods property on every single function that ever comes into existence?
Because you might want to add functions on the object.
You might want to add functions onto that dot methods object.
On any object that you might create, so because you might need every time you just include it and you spend your eyes on the name.
Exactly. So it may be the case that that function will be used as a class. And if the person writing that function wanted to use it as a class, they'd do this. They'd say var result equals object.create. And then they'd have to talk about, you know, that function dot methods, and they'd have to build a whole methods property and put an object there. But Brendan Eich said, no, we will save that line of code. Developers will never have to type class name dot methods equals an object. I'm going to put it on every single function. Does it make sense why, when you press enter, you're going to see an object on this brand new vanilla function? Are there any questions about why you're about to see an object when you press enter? Okay, press enter. I lied. I lied for a good reason.
I was so excited.
I lied for a good reason. I didn't totally lie. Brendan and I did exactly that. He noticed this code that he kept writing. He said, object.create. I love this personified Brendan Eich that I get. I don't hang out with Brendan Eich. I didn't ask him what he was thinking. I just pretend like we're pals and we're sipping lemonade. And I'm like, what's up with the dot methods thing? And that never happened. But he was writing all of this code. And he said, you know what? I do this so much, I'm going to make methods available everywhere, on every single function. Here's the problem. He didn't call it dot methods. He called it dot prototype. That's what he used as his standard name for what? What is dot prototype the standard name for? Which I was calling in my whole slideshow dot methods. What is it? What is it for? What is that object going to be for?
For initializing?
It's not for initializing, no. Good guess. Keep going.
Delegating.
It's the object to which car instances are going to delegate. So a function, like a car factory, will have an object that all things coming off of the factory line should delegate to. Somewhere, like, instead of me saying, I'm going to make a factory, so, you know, generates me a function. And then separately, I'm also going to make an object that everything coming off of that factory line delegates to. Factories just come with one of these prototypes, waiting for me to specify what they're like. The problem is, by naming it .prototype, he chose to confuse everyone forever. Because the relationship that a car factory has with one of these prototypes is nothing similar to what we talk about when we say a prototype. Buggy has a relationship with car.prototype, and car has a relationship with car.prototype. They are very different relationships, but they're both called being its prototype. So, pop quiz. What object is the prototype of car? Yeah, which object?
Your first function.
The first function here is car itself. That is the car factory object. So, but what is its prototype?
So you're saying all the stuff that's it's delegating to the object?
Well, when I say car's prototype, what object do you think I'm referring to? The car function's prototype. Object.
Oh.
No, move is something that is available on a prototype, but you're on the right track. This object here, we might call car's prototype. Right? I mean, that's the way that some people use the word prototype. They say, oh, well, the car prototype, the prototype of car, is this object right here.
Okay.
Does car delegate to that object? Does the car function delegate failed lookups to this object? When I say car.move, will I get a property of this object because it fails on car and falls through this? I won't, because car has never been set up using object.create to delegate anyway. I didn't create car using object.create, so I don't get something that delegates to an object I specify. The only relationship car has with prototype is the same relationship a car factory in the real world would have to the prototype that it keeps outside next to it. In the real world, there's a car factory somewhere. And every time they build a car, they reference a prototype. They look at it and they're like, it's got to be like this. Sweet. The relationship between the car factory and the prototype of a car is not one where failed lookups on the factory fall through to the car. I don't go looking for what color is the factory, fail to find it, and consult this prototype of a car. I can't call factory.move and drive the factory away because the factory delegates to the prototype of a car. Do you see what I'm saying? This is very confusing, trust me.
Yeah.
So I told you that this was the most complex hurdle that we're taking together. So it's totally all right, plus we're really tired. It's totally all right, but I'm not going to let you go. So the car factory, in our analogy, is not thought to have some delegation relationship with a prototype. But something that comes off of the car factory line, a brand new buggy, can be expected to delegate failed lookups to that prototype. So when I say buggy.move, it's supposed to delegate over to this prototype.
When you say delegate, you really mean just passing whatever information it has about that object.
Yes, by delegate I mean the delegating object fails a key lookup and consults with the prototype object to see what properties the prototype might have that can satisfy the same key lookup. That's what I mean when I say delegating.
Okay.
So the prototype, or sorry, the buggy instance delegates per se to this object, this prototype object. And that's one relationship you can have with that object. You would probably call that a prototype relationship. You would say, the buggy's prototype is this thing, this car prototype. Another way you could use the word its prototype is you could say, what is the car factory's prototype? But you wouldn't be talking about what the car factory delegates to. You would be talking about the prototype it keeps handy so that when it makes new cars, they will delegate there. Do you see the difference? We're imagining some awesome looking sort of prototype car. It's probably like a DeLorean, right? It's fantastic, this cool car. It doesn't work very well because it's not really a drivable, actual car. It's just got all the shared infrastructure we're supposed to put on every car. We know that the factory has some relationship with that car. It uses that relationship to produce new cars. And we know that all the new cars have some relationship with that prototype car. They actually delegate their failed lookups. And my claim is just that these are two very different relationships. So I'm trying to make clear to you guys how confusing of a naming choice this was for Brendan Eich to make. He made us use this word in two very different ways. He made us talk about what buggy delegates to as being the buggy's prototype. And that poor guy, if he ever watches this video, he's going to be so pissed at me. We met once at like JSConf before, and he's probably never going to talk to me. Anyway, he inspired it to be the case that when we talk about buggy's prototype, we are talking about this object that I keep gesturing at here. And he also made it the case, by this naming choice, that for a factory to have a dot prototype property means we think that a car dot prototype is its prototype. And everyone mixes these ideas together in their mind. Everyone thinks that the car function will delegate to car dot prototype, or that buggy has a dot prototype property that it delegates to. It doesn't. Only functions have that prototype. Remember how I was convincing you that every function has a dot methods? When I told you that, did you think that brand new objects would have a dot methods property? Non-function objects? Non-function objects would not have dot methods because the whole story here was about what are we going to make things delegate to when we instantiate it? You can't instantiate an object. You can't run an object to build more things. So for that reason, the word prototype is ambiguous. It has these two meanings, and they're very confusing. Lastly, because it's made available automatically, we don't have to type the line of code where we specify the prototype. It's given to us for free. Much like my claimed dot methods property was going to come for free, when you pressed enter, you were going to see it. If you type foo.prototype and you press enter, you will see that. I promise. So we don't need to type this because it's provided for us. And there's only one more plot twist here. Brendan Eich presented this language to Netscape, and he was like, hey, what do you think? And they're like, it's sweet. You know what's really popular these days is Java. Came out earlier this year. Major adoption. They're putting lots of money behind it. Could you change the name of your language from Oak or whatever it was to JavaScript to confuse everyone? And then add some syntactic sugar, like new, that makes it look like Java? And he's like, it's nothing similar to Java. It's like totally different language. They're like, oh, I know. But no one's going to like this language if you leave it kind of simple and pure. You need to pollute it with a bunch of cruft. And so he instituted this brand new keyword that confuses everyone. The keyword new behaves approximately, almost exactly like this. When I put the keyword new in front of a function invocation, so here's a function invocation, car, I'm calling it, I'm passing something in, and I put these two parens, so I'm activating the function. But if I run it with the keyword new, the interpreter will run that function with a couple of extra lines of code sort of zipped in just for that one invocation. It will run the code as if I had typed more code than I did. So at runtime, it'll kind of scribble in these two lines of code. You don't need to read those two lines of code. I want you first to buy into the setup. You're reading the lines of code. I can see it. I can see it in your eyes. Don't read the lines of code. Buy into the claim that using the keyword new has the effect of inserting two lines of code around your actual code and then running your code as if you wrote it a little differently with those two extra lines of code. And then let's explore what's up there. So the first line of code that it inserts is this object.create line. It runs object.create for you, and it passes in the function being called .prototype. Because why not? You put .prototype on every function for free, so why not write this line of code for you for free anytime you call a function with the keyword new? That seems useful, then you won't have to type object.create. But wait a minute, where is this thing going to be automatically stored? Where are we going to put this brand new object? Idea, why not store it in the keyword this? The keyword this will not behave the way it does like method call. There won't be a dot. You don't see a dot down here at call time. So there's nothing to the left of the dot. And we're not going to bind it to window like idiots, right? We're going to bind it to the brand new object created by object.create. This really kind of works because methods talk about some target instance. That's why the keyword this was useful. Constructor functions also talk about a target instance that they're building. So the keyword this has the same or similar meaning there. To support your intuition that the keyword this is talking about the new relevant instance, he made it bind this new object to the keyword this. And then, of course, at the end, he's like, you know, everybody has to return the instance at the end of a constructor function. I might as well do the returning for them automatically. And if you don't specify a return yourself, which would sort of bail out early, then the return this gets hit by the inserted return this. So basically, if I didn't have this line in here, I would hit this line. But since I did write this line, we'll never get here. These extra lines of code are inserted, and my code is run as if they were there. Yeah?
So if you're object creating on this, you don't have to do that on the result as well. So would you do this.speed and this.location instead of result.speed?
Great question. How do we change our source code that we wrote knowing that the interpreter is going to insert this because of the keyword new? The answer is like this. We're going to delete the redundant code that is basically a duplication of what's inserted automatically. We're going to delete that. We're going to delete that. And then we're going to change, since we won't have a result variable anymore, but we do have this, we're going to change result to talk about this. So I'm going to erase these lines of code that we all know are invisibly being inserted in. This is the code you found on the internet, but no one explained. It's like ridiculous. It's like, why does anyone give a tutorial where they treat this as if it's intuitive when there are like 7 very complex important rules governing what the keyword this is talking about and why it's very different from method calling versus construction, and the prototype being this automatic thing that is not delegated to by the constructor function, and nor do the instances delegate to the constructor function. It's like all of this complexity, but people just flash this stuff up like in a moment of triumph, like, I figured it out. They don't actually understand what they're typing necessarily. They just got it to work. And they're like, the way that you do pseudo-classical instantiation. And then they go on and like write a blog post that does not illuminate any of the complexity that you guys have just really kind of like dragged yourself through. And I apologize for how long it took. It's not my fault, I swear. You are now, in my opinion, you have leapfrogged past some year or two of personal development as a JavaScript programmer that I personally had to do the hard way. And then after that, I got so upset that there weren't better resources that I started cultivating these slideshows and thinking there have got to be more efficient ways to come to these conclusions. If you haven't followed along with every beat, that's totally cool, because we're still here. We're going to float around and kind of help people out. I don't want to go too far over, because we've been over an hour, and it's generally really hard to focus for that long. So I'd like to take like one more question and then break into, you guys free to go home. I highly recommend you kind of like hack for a little bit and cement these concepts while we have TAs handy. It's the last day of it, and we flew them in for you. But I don't want to keep you prisoner if you have dinner plans or something like that. Yeah, do you have a question?
Yeah, so if you had left in the whole pile of this bar build equal and all that, yeah, you know, you'd have to go back and do that. So if you actually keep it that way, is new car and car actually would be for one then?
Yes. If I type my code this way, and of course I don't type these things because they're going to be inserted by the keyword new. If I type my code this way, I'm basically doing all of the work myself and then short-circuiting the automatic return. So I would not expect the implied return this to ever be reached, nor would I expect it to matter what this is bound to. My code doesn't refer to the keyword this, and so the binding of this is unimportant. And my code returns something, so the automatic return isn't important. You're absolutely right. If I don't refactor my code around my knowledge of how the keyword new works, then calling car is the same as calling new car. There are a couple of tiny asterisks on that I won't go into, but if you're watching the video and you're like, meh, I know about that stuff. Don't even try.
Does that mean you can return a null or undefined from a instructor?
You got me. That was the thing I was not going to tell you. The only... You don't want to know this fact. You can't unlearn it. It'll just confuse you. Okay. Let's talk you and me after. It's really confusing. Yeah?
Is there some way to declare the car factory in such a way that you define function and prototype methods in one common statement rather than...
Is there some convenience syntax that allows me to declare both the car and its prototype methods in one big go, rather than a bunch of cobbling together some weird statements? And we're not even done, actually. There's some other things we probably need to do to sort of clean this code up a little bit. No, there's not, unless you use one of these libraries like backbones.extend. There are a lot of attempts to simplify the class creation story, and unfortunately they tend to make it worse then they make it better. What was the thing?
We have to take a picture.
Oh, we have to take a picture like, oh, it's everybody goes in the big family picture of everybody. All right, so what we don't get to do is circulate and help you right now, but we're probably just going to come back to this room, and if there are enough of you who are interested in working through some of the material and kind of confirming what you know already, then we'll try to help you out. Let's all take a picture. Hey, thanks for coming, everybody. Remember to talk to the organizers if you enjoyed this, and I had a good time.